Dear learners, welcome to NIOS course on Sociology. I am Dr. Elena Samantroy from the Vivigiri National Labour Institute. Today, we will discuss the lesson on economy, polity and religion. Learners, in this lesson, you will be able to describe the basic institutions found in society, explain the characteristics of each of these institutions, understand the relationship between the institutions. Learners, you might be aware that in a society is functioning because of various social institutions. These social institutions are based on the economic, political, religious and other kinds of institutions. The entire social organization is based on the functioning of these institutions. So, social institutions are extremely important for the smooth functioning of the society. Today, we will understand and try to learn important social institutions like economy, polity and religion. Learners, now let us understand what is an economy. You must be aware that many people in every society, they exchange certain goods and services between themselves for monetary or transactions. Now, economy is concerned with the production, exchange, distribution and consumption of goods and services. We might have seen that economy in a market, for example, the market economy where people sell, produce, sell and people buy certain products. So, economy is concerned with production, exchange, distribution and consumption of goods and services. Now, none of these activities in the economy are carried out in isolation. So, the economy cannot function in isolation. It has to depend on various other social institutions for its smooth functioning. So, economic institution is one which is concerned with the social relations that are built in the systems of production, distribution, exchange and consumption. Now, learners, economic institution had existed since long, though in the modern day economic institution is much more complex, but in the previous social order, we used to find simple economic institutions based on simple exchange of goods and services like the barter system. But in modern complex industrialized societies, the economic system also is based on complex social relationships and it becomes much more complex in nature. Now, learners, let us understand another important institution which exists in society, which is called polity. Polity is concerned with the distribution of power in society. We all know that in every society, social regulation is extremely important for any deviant behavior to be controlled and regulated. So, a political organization is very important as it is concerned with how power is distributed in the society. If you look at polity from a sociological perspective, we see how do we explain power? We see that power is the ability of a person to exercise his will on others and obtain compliance. It is also the ability to take decision for oneself and for others. For example, we have seen in many families, the head of the household exercises power. For example, in a joint family, we had seen how the karta or the male head of the family had the supreme power with him and used to exercise power over other members, and each and every member are bound to follow the decisions taken by the karta in the family. So, political institution is based on power relations in a society, and power is concerned with polity is concerned with the distribution of power in every society. Now, what is political power then? We have understood what is power, what is polity, but power has got a dimension that is called political power. The difference between power in any institution, for example, like judiciary of a group or like family, and political power is that the latter has wider application. So, power in institution or power in a group and political power are different, and political power in fact has much more wider scope and wider application than power which is confined in a particular social institution. it is not confined to one particular institution. So political power is one sort of power which is not confined to one particular institution or group. Rather, it can embrace all of them. So each and every institution can be a part of political power. So political power is also closely concerned with governance. An Italian sociologist, Wilfred Pareto, made a distinction between different types of governing people like elites. Learners, you must be knowing that elites are members of society who have control over power, position and authority. So Pareto made a distinction between types of elites. According to him, there are two types of elites, the governing elite. They are those people who exercise power to govern and rule, and the non-governing elite who excel in their work but do not govern. So governing elites can be the prime minister of a society or in a country, who would be the supreme head of political authority in any country. And non-governing elite are people who do well in the field, like artists, actors, or people who are renowned writers, authors, who do good work, but they generally do not govern, but they are also considered elite who are non-governing in nature. Now, learners, let us understand a very important social institution in every society and which has existed since times immemorial in every society, which is called religion. Learners, you must have heard about the famous sociologist Emile Durkheim. In his book Elementary Forms of Religious Life, he defined this social institution. Now let us try to understand what is religion and how do we define religion. According to Durkheim, in his book Elementary Forms of Religious Life, a religion is a unified system of beliefs and practices relative to sacred things, that is to say, things set apart and forbidden, beliefs and practices which unite people into one single moral community called a church. So, learners, religion is actually a system of beliefs and practices which are considered sacred in nature. Religion basically unites people. You must have seen that in certain places people go to common places of worship and sit together and pray together. They are bound in one feeling, a feeling of moral community. They are bound with community sentiment. So religion binds people into one single moral community because the faith, the belief, the practices which they have are common in nature. Now let us understand, learners, the characteristic of economic organization. We have understood economic institution. We have to see what are the basic characteristic of an economic organization. Economic organization are based on two important characteristic. One is division of labor and the other is industrial economy. Now, division of labor, we have seen, is a concept which also Emile Durkheim has spoken about in his doctoral thesis on division of labor in society. Division of labor is basically how labor is divided between people in a society, and it is equitable distribution of labor in every society. It is based on the principle of specialization. Certain people were specialized to do certain activities and hence the work was divided accordingly. For example, in tribal societies we had simple division of labor. For example, hunting and gathering societies where men hunted and women gathered. So this was based on the principle of simple division of labor. But as societies moved on and with passage of time, societies became industrialized, it was complex. Now, for example, to understand division of labor, if we see an industrial organization, we see the workers, the supervisor, the managerial level, the head of the industry, all of them have different kinds of work and all of them are interlinked, and division of labor is also based on the principle of interdependence. Each and every person is functioning for the contribution of the whole industry, and each and every function is interdependent and interrelated to each other. Now let us understand another important characteristic of the economic organization, which is the industrial economy. Now the industrial economy is an important aspect of economy, and it is based on primary, secondary and tertiary sectors. It explains on how an industry functions in an economy. Primary industrial economy is based on agriculture and related activities, agriculture and allied services. The secondary economy is based on manufacturing, trade and many other secondary economic activities. And the tertiary sectors are basically the service sectors. So, in an economic institution or in an industrial economy, these three important sectors are extremely important for the smooth functioning of the industrial society. Learners, now let us understand what are the types of economic systems. Economic systems are basically divided into two important types. One is food collection and the other one is food production. Now let us understand what is food collection. Food collection is defined as deriving food from naturally occurring resources such as wild animals and plants. At one time, the entire society consisted of food collectors. In fact, food collection has occupied the longest period in the history of humankind or mankind. For example, you must have seen certain tribal communities who were engaged in collection of food, like the Bushmen of South Africa's Kalahari Desert, the Australian tribes, the Eskimos and tribes in Andaman Islands. All of them were involved in traditional food collecting. Another important aspect of an economic system or type of economic system is based on food production. Now, food production is further divided into three main types or three main production systems. One is horticulture. Horticulture is an aspect or is an economic mode of food production where we mean the growing of crops of all kinds with relatively simple technology and material culture. You must have seen we have government departments of horticulture in India presently, and horticulture is an important aspect of food production system in India also. Another system of food production is intensive agriculture. Intensive agriculture is also known as settled agriculture. It's a system of food production where the fields are regularly cultivated and they're regularly irrigated. Technology which is used is also complex in nature. So, food production is based on certain types of or certain systems. Another aspect is pastoralism. Communities of people which domesticate animals are known as pastoral, and system of deriving one's livelihood by domesticating animals is known as pastoralism. Learners, you must have seen many nomadic tribes who were engaged in protecting or domesticating animals, which is known as pastoralism. Pastoralism is in fact an effective way of living in semi-arid and desert areas. For example, the tribes of Middle East, the Lapps of Scandinavia, etc. are people or communities who were engaged in pastoralism, or pastoralism was one of the activities of deriving their livelihood options. Now, learners, let us move on to understand economic systems of simple and complex societies and see how they are different from each other. Economy in simple societies tends to be subsistent in nature, which means production is mainly for consumption. It's certainly not for the market or commercial interest. In early societies, we had seen hunting-gathering societies or simple societies where people actually produced to, and the economy was basically for their own consumption. There was no market and there was no commercial interest involved in this. For example, family in simple traditional societies is both a unit of production and unit of consumption. The members of a family work together on a family farm and produce what they need for their existence. Similarly, if you look into, or contrastingly, if you look into family in complex societies, it is a unit of consumption, not a unit of production, because the processes of production and distribution are centered in the market and are complex in nature. So, simple societies are basically subsistence oriented and modern societies are market oriented. So, economic systems vary across simple and complex societies. Now, learners, let us understand the systems of exchange. Systems of exchange, if you look into the systems of exchange, we see that there are three types of exchange found in human society. respectively called reciprocity, redistribution and the market. Now, what is reciprocity? Reciprocity is the exchange between individuals who occupy equal positions. What is redistribution? Redistribution is exchange relationship between people who are unequal. So, reciprocity happens between people who are in equal positions, and redistribution happens between people who are in superior position or who than the latter or who are in unequal position. And the third one is market. Market is an important system of exchange which has existed in many societies, and it is an important mode of economic mode of functioning in every society. The market is in fact is the third principle of exchange. There are two aspects to the market. First, the market refers to the physical place where people assemble to carry out exchanges, where people assemble for buying and selling. This may be called the market site. You must have gone to a regular market and seen how there are vegetable vendors, many vendors selling, and there are many people who are buying. This is typically a market site. Secondly, the forces of demand and supply determine the price of goods and services that are available at the market. This principle is called the market principle. Markets have existed both in simple and complex societies. Let us understand how the market is different in a simple society and how it is different in a complex society. First, those that do not have any concept of the market side, they are called marketless societies, the simple societies or the hunting and gathering type of societies, where we see there was no existence of a market and people worked on the basis of simple division of labor. There was no concept of the market side. Secondly, those simple societies which have market size, where people assemble for exchanging their goods and services but have no market principle. For example, in simple societies like the tribal societies, where they do a certain kind of exchange of goods and services for goods and services, sell small products and get something in exchange of that. So, these kind of societies are basically the tribal societies. Another aspect of exchange system which is no more existent now but was very much existent in the past is the barter system. Simple societies have the barter system, that is a type of exchange in the absence of money, where goods are exchanged for goods. The concerned society decides which goods will be exchanged with which ones. Learners, you must have heard about the Jajmani system. Jajmani system is a traditional system of exchange in the Indian society which had existed since times immemorial, and the Jajmani system over the years have slightly disintegrated. It is based on two groups of people, the Jajmans, to whom the Kamins serve. So, the Jajmans and Kamins. The Jajmans will be the people who belong to a hierarchy where they are superior in nature, and the Kamins are the servicing caste who would serve the Jajmans in terms of goods and services. So, barter system is an important system of exchange where there is absence of money but the goods are exchanged for goods. Learners, we have learnt about so many aspects of an institution, like the economic institution, the political institution, the religious institution. Now, let us try to understand what is economic development and how economic development happens in any country. We all know that basic goals of economic development are basically to reduce to the maximum the phenomena of hunger and scarcity, and to make people self-reliant so that they are no more dependent on outsiders for the fulfillment of their basic needs, for full exploitation of the kind of natural resources or the kind of resources available in the country, human resources, and make it economically more developed. For achieving both of these goals, the community in which change is to be brought out also must be involved. So, economic development happens in various phases in every society. We had simple society, but when the society progressed, when there was industrialization, there was massive economic development. From now, we have an agricultural economy. An agricultural economy is developing over the years with high yielding variety of seeds, which with good fertilizers, and there is massive economic development in the agricultural sector. So, economic development is an important aspect where people in every society are removed from the plagues of poverty and hunger and are moved to economic well-being. So the Sustainable Development Goals, which we have presently, 2030 of the United Nations, focus on overall development apart from economic development, overall development of every society and addressing the well-being of the society. So it's very important that for any kind of economic development to happen in any country, the role of community participation is extremely important. So the community must be involved and brought to the levels of community membership, community partnership, community involvement is extremely important. So learners, today we learnt about an important lesson in sociology. Thank you.